Good morning, everyone. A very blessed Sunday morning to all of you today. Thank you for joining us today as we come to worship our God together. The Lord be with you and also with you. Praise the Lord, praising you servants of the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his name, now and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Now we pray the collect for today. Lord of heaven and earth, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and power of your church. Sow in our hearts the seeds of grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Peter Southey will now read the gospel lesson for us today. Thank you, Peter.
Good morning. Today's gospel is taken from Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 to 30, and verses 36 to 43. The parable of the weeds. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like this. A man sowed good seed in his field. One night when everyone was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the plants grew and the ears of corn began to form, the weeds showed up. The manservant came to him and said, "Sir, it was good seed you sowed in your field. Where did the weeds come from?" "It was some enemy who did this," he answered. "Do you want us to go and pull up the weeds?" they asked him. "No," he answered, "because as you gather the weeds, you might pull up some of the wheat along with them. Let the wheat and the weeds both grow together until harvest. Then I will tell the harvest workers to pull up the weeds first, tie them in bundles and burn them, and then to gather in the wheat and put it in my barn." Jesus explains the parable of the weeds. When Jesus had left the crowd and gone indoors, his disciples came to him and said, "Tell us what the parable about the weeds in the field mean." Jesus answered, "The man who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed is the people who belong to the kingdom. The weeds are the people who belong to the evil one. And the enemy who sowed the weeds is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvest workers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered up and burnt in the fire, so the same thing will happen at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels to gather up out of his kingdom all those who cause people to sin and all others who do evil things. And then they will throw them into the fiery furnace, where they will cry and grind their teeth. Then God's people will shine like the sun of their Father's kingdom. Listen then, if you have ears." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Over the last few weeks, we've been looking at the different parts of Jesus' preachings about the sower. We have heard about the soil last week, and all of us, I'm sure, would love to be in the good soil. Today we hear something slightly different though. Jesus teaches a different parable. And once again we have heard that the soil is set before the sower. And the sower is Jesus, who comes to bring the message about God's kingdom to the people upon earth. And the seed is thrown in amongst the soil, and it germinates and it grows and does extremely well. But Jesus goes on to bring out another aspect to his teaching, and that is that there are weeds that grow up in between the good soil. And these weeds come and grow up there, and the farm workers come and say, should we not just tear out all of these weeds? But the sower is scared, because what happens if some of the good gets taken out with the weeds? And you see, this creates a great interest for us today. For us today to come to that point and perhaps to deal with something that we need to learn and take for sure. And that is firstly that there is an end to the world. There is an end to our lives upon this planet. And we have to be preparing on this earth while we still have a choice as to what we do with our spiritual life. Many people ignore that they even have a spiritual life or a spiritual relationship with God. But we are also told that there is no evil in heaven. Only those that have been brought and made good will go to God eternal life and to enter into that glorious life. And you see, the Bible often questions something and says, why is it that the evil seem to prosper so beautifully in this world? And we often draw brought to that same question. Why does God allow suffering in this world? And there are many different answers as to perhaps for us to try and understand. How can it be that a God of love could allow things to take place that seem so horrendous within our world? And you see, we have to look through the entire scriptures to find an answer. One of the answers is that we see that God created his world. He didn't make it perfect. But Genesis tells us that God made it good for the purpose for what it was meant to be. But God took some major risks when he created us as human beings. God could have, if he just wanted fellowship with people, make us be born perfect in heaven and just be perfect in his glory. But God wanted to set us free, to give us a free choice to accept his love and to come and be with him. He would not force us to love him, but gave us a choice and a freedom to choose whether we wanted to love him and believe in him and accept through Jesus Christ the forgiveness of sins and our entry into God's glorious kingdom. And you see, we often suffer in two different ways within this world. We suffer because of the choices that we make and the consequences of those choices. We suffer because of relationships that we cannot manage to keep going, and they can cause us a great deal of stress and a great deal of discomfort within our own lives. And sometimes we can suffer just purely because of the biology of our makeup as human beings, the genes that we have inherited from those in our distant ancestry. Some of our genes are just good and strong, and some aren't. Some people sadly are afflicted with a great deal of difficulties and pain within their own bodies. It's not God's fault, but just the consequences of what was happened. Most of you know that I am absolutely passionate about things that fly. My whole life long has really been attached in one way or another with model aeroplaning, possibly for my own frustration of never being able to become a real pilot of my own. And so I continue to be a pilot, but upon this earth, and experience the joy of the modeling and flying of model aeroplanes. There are many different disciplines within models, and I want to share a little bit about those model aeroplanes to make the point about how God perhaps has given us our choice and our freedom of choice. You see, we first of all have radio control, which most people will know. There's an electrical signal that is generated from a transmitter to a receiver on board on the aeroplane. Part of what we are trying to do is to fly that aeroplane so well that we place it exactly in the sky where we want it to be. There's always wind, air movements, different types of lift and sink within air. It's never a consistent. There's always something different. And we are trying to, with the radio control, control a plane that we are watching and to place it where we exactly want it to go. What altitude, what height, what speed, they're all the factors that I'm constantly adjusting to place it to make it do the stunts and aerobatics that I want it to do. So that's radio control. We fly gliders in that same way. We fly slope soaring, where you just throw a glider off into the up drafts of wind which carry your plane, and you fly without any need for any power because you'll fly in the lift that is generated off the slopes and hills. And then you get what's called control line, my true passion. I have a control handle, and about 20 meters at the end of the control handle is attached my aeroplane. And I am attached to that plane and to that feel. I get a lot of feedback from the feel of that aeroplane into my hand. And in a way, I'm more in control of being piloting because I'm actually attached to that plane flying. But there's another whole discipline of modeling, one I used to do when I was a child, when there were open spaces that we could enjoy. That is called free flight. We'd set up our models, put the fuel in the little engine, get it going, and then we would let it go. And that moment that it has left the grasp of your fingers, it is in free flight. There is no ways to control it. There's no radio signal, no connection with it whatsoever. But it is given true freedom and true flight. It is no longer governed by my control or inputs. And that is true flight. It is given freedom to fly. We offset the rudder and we set up the elevator to give it a certain amount of lift. And those are all the little things that we played around to make it do and perform in a certain way. But it is given true flight. And you see, God could be a controlling God. And God looked at his world and said, you know, people are really bad and they've done terrible things. And God let a great flood come and take out many, many people. And God allowed that to happen. But God also made a deal with humankind. Because God created us with freedom. God said, I will not do this anymore to humankind. And God stopped punishing these human beings when they could not live the way he wanted to. And sometimes human beings just gave up completely on God. And other circumstances happened and situations developed that moved us beyond that position. But God made that deal to give us freedom of choice. God gave us freedom to choose. He set us free to fly freely. And God did not want us built as a bunch of puppets to just be born into his kingdom, but gave us this choice while we are here on this earth. And so while we live on this earth, there will be problems that we will develop. People make decisions which affect our lives. People make decisions because they are in control of our own lives. And they make decisions that will hurt us and affect our finances, whatever else actually takes place within this world. But God will not violate that choice of making us free. If he did, he would have to take every single one of us out when we have sinned and God against what God would want us to be. God made another plan to say, let me send Jesus Christ into this world and I will take responsibility for giving human beings that freedom of choice so that when they have chosen to sin, by the punishment that God had to deal with in order to bring about righteousness and justice, because our sins could not be just swept under some rug and be forgotten about. They had to be dealt with. And you see, for God to purify us, to get us to be made perfect again, to go to the eternal kingdom, God decided through his Son Jesus Christ to bring about that perfection. But while we live in this world, let us know that our every action is not dictated by God. God has given us opportunity and set us free to fly free, to choose what we do. And God knows that we live amongst the weeds, the difficulties of life and the difficulty of decisions that others make around us. But in the end, there will come that day when our lives would end and we would be taken to the glory of God's eternal kingdom through his Son Jesus Christ. And the evil that exists within this world will be dealt with in a different way. And there will come a day where God has had enough of the world and the people, and God will bring it to an end. And so while we are on this earth, let us choose about our relationship with our God. And let us turn to our God in love and let us turn to the greatness of the Lord. Throughout the scriptures we see people that through no choice of their own suffer a great deal, but the greatness lies in our spiritual life in relationship with God in his eternal kingdom. And so let us not lose hope when we see difficulties around us, or we suffer within our own world, or we suffer within our own lives. It is not punishment sent by God, but sometimes just circumstances that are as if it were part of just this natural struggle of humankind within this world. Our world is not perfect. Our physical bodies are not perfect. We have to reach an end somewhere, somehow within our bodies for them to come to an end. God is pre-programmed within it. While we live on this earth, our bodies slowly deteriorate, but our spiritual life and spiritual nature never changes. We are new every day with God and live in that assurance of God's presence with us and the hope of knowing that we will be with God at the end of our lives in his eternal kingdom. And so let us take courage this day in knowing our God, and let's turn to him and try to be the best seed we can possibly be within this world and produce the biggest harvest we possibly can for God, because we have a choice as to what we do. We can go through life ignoring, trying to do what God wants us to do, or we can put in a bit of effort and do what God wishes us to do for him. But let us rejoice today in knowing that immense freedom of choice that God created us with, and let us share the joy of knowing God with those around us. May God bless you during the course of this week. Amen.
For the kingdom. Spirit flow, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Have your way, Holy Spirit.